Begin with our pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right. And we will begin with our acceptance of our agenda. So can I have a motion to accept our agenda tonight?
So moved.
Somebody else, please?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And that brings us quickly to your report.
All righty. Good evening, everyone. Nice to see everybody tonight, colleagues, community members. I'd like to begin with acknowledging one of our board trustees, and we just recently received a certificate in the mail recognizing Mr. Hanna for his level of board achievement in his professional development for earning 75 professional growth points, and which earns the Board Achievement Award. So we'd like to congratulate
the award for showing up,
Mr. Hanna.
Do we have a picture we can take?
Oh, yes. Look at that.
And then, secondly, we also have similar honor for our fine board president, Mr. Whitney.
Oh.
So congratulations, Mr. Whitney.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So it's nice to see you committed to your professional growth as a board.
Thank you.
So thank you.
I assume that would stay on a pile in on Elaine's desk. So
yeah.
You can frame it and hang it up at home now.
Right.
So a few important things to report upon this evening. It's certainly a busy time of year for us. And as we acknowledged at the last board meeting, we have unfortunately an added responsibility of finding a replacement, even though we cannot replace her. Beverly, as our assistant superintendent for business, our search is ongoing. We did put out a call for a community member to participate in the search committee, so there's still an opportunity for folks to respond. And if you know any interested qualified folks, the police, encourage them to submit their application through OLAS. I did want to follow up on some business from the prior board meeting where a community member presented some concern with respect to the use of electronic devices, in particular at the middle school, and I just want to assure the board and the community that Mr. Sotile and I have certainly followed up and not only reviewed our code of conduct to make sure that it does in fact align with the BYOD policy, but he is going to look to make this as a point of discussion with respect to some future work with the technology committee in the middle school. So thank you, for Mr. Sotile, for your effort on that front. Also, as many people may have seen, our PTSA has launched a fundraiser where they are actually selling inscribed bricks that you can purchase. This project fundraiser is going to support projects to beautify our school campuses. The first project is going to be looking at beautifying the middle school, high school campus. And in their current fundraising effort, they're looking to install a paver patio in the quad that will be in the area where all the picnic tables are. So we certainly look forward to success with this and encourage anyone to come out, and whether you want to recognize your child, a teacher, a graduating class, or just, go Irvington Bulldogs. And information can be found for this great fundraiser on the PTSA website. And we want, Sherry, since you're here, thank the PTSA for your continued support on this front. Bev and I attended a meeting last week, and Phil and Michael attended another meeting regarding the homestead tax option that is currently associated with the reassessment in Greenberg. But they were really trying to explain some of the specifics regarding the homestead tax structure and the path that Greenberg is going on. And Bev, would you want to provide a few details for the board and community on the place that they're in and what it means for the district?
Okay. Well, the homestead, non-homestead,
is a determination, it's a two-tier taxing structure, whereas now we have one. Everyone has the same tax rate. Basically, there's some little nuances, but basically it's commercial and some co-ops versus residential. The town has to make the decision first whether it's going to be a two-tier system, because our school district is all within one township, one taxing entity, so we don't have that option. If the town decides to go with the two-tier system, then the school district is automatically included in that, but you have the opportunity to opt out of it. And there would be a short window for the school district to do that, because once the new assessments come out for the assessor, they need to know what towns and schools are opting in or opting out before they send out the assessment letters to the residents.
And the homestead, I'll just add this, yeah. The homestead provision or decision is only available to towns that have gone through the reassessment. It's
correct.
Kind of tied to that.
Correct.
And the purpose, theoretically, is that if the town has gone through a reassessment and residential properties may now be at a higher valuation, the two-tiered structure is a way of sort of easing the pain for residents, because you'd establish two different tax rates, one for
correct.
Commercial property. So you can imagine that there's a downside for commercial properties, that they might be unhappy
mm-hmm.
in the town of Greenberg to have a different tax rate than residential properties.
Correct.
So the town board is, as we were told at this meeting, they're hoping to make a decision before the end of February, and then they would quickly turn around and share information with the school districts, and we would then have the opportunity to entertain our participation in it. However, should Greenberg choose not to enter into
right.
the homestead, non-homestead arrangement, there is nothing for our board to consider.
Right.
So we certainly look forward to sharing more information as it is available. Dr. Cordy, do you have a few things that you'd like?
And I just kind of just add one. Cause so what they told us is that we would probably have to have a special meeting. We're not going to have a lot of time to, if they decide to go ahead with the homestead decision, then we would have to make a very quick decision within a matter of 2 weeks. So depending on where that falls in our schedule, we might have to have a special meeting.
Can you provide some, I mean, I have no clue how this works or what it is. I mean,
it's the town of,
other
it's
than the word two-tier. But so can you provide some background information? So we
there is a packet of background information underneath your pen right now. Those were materials that were distributed at the meeting. A copy was brought for each of the board members that was not present.
We didn't get soft copies.
It looks like it's just a copy of the statute, but well, there's
another there's some PowerPoint
there too. Okay.
And it's the Town of Greenberg board that has the responsibility to make that decision
and this would take effect for the
17-18, not 16-17.
Okay, is that also when the reassessment takes effect?
Yes. But homeowners are informed about their new tax rate, their new situation in
mid-March.
Yeah.
Mid-March of this year.
Yeah, so
16.
Right, so the way that the tax assessor explained it to us is the Board of Town of Greenberg will make their decision about homestead or not by the end of February. So I think, yeah, by the end of February, and that leaves very little time for us then to either do nothing, which means homestead would be in place, or to opt out, because they have to prepare those letters to all the homeowners. And obviously, if they go with homestead, then the tax rate changes for all homeowners according to the new formula. And I just hope that we are provided with enough data when we have to make our decisions so that we're making an informed decision. They said we would be,
mm-hmm.
but.
If Greenberg doesn't approve it, we have nothing that we need to do, but if
that's
they
right.
do, we have suddenly a very significant process that we have to reflect on and make a decision on.
Right. Has the town given any indication whether they're likely to go that way or not?
Not really.
Yeah.
Not really. It's still under discussion.
There's, I think they were waiting for some additional data, or something to that effect.
Yeah, I think so.
For the reassessment, I mean, is that, don't they get that information in terms of what the...
Right.
Or at the very least, the residents will start learning, will get information about the reassessment in March or something like that?
In March, right, right.
And I guess we should be transparent and explain that the critical issue that they're wrestling with, aside from the impact on commercial properties, is that condo owners would be theoretically negatively impacted because their properties would be assessed according to the market value of their properties, not according to the rent calculated way, which is how condo owners are currently assessed today. And so what we heard was that a number of condo owners have actually been beseeching the Town of Greenberg Board to not do this because they're paying 30% to 40% below market rate, according to what they told us.
But we have nothing to do with that.
We have nothing to do with that either.
Well, yeah, it's yeah. Right.
But if there are condo owners who are watching here in Irvington.
And right, and if we end up having to make a decision, it would conceivably affect condo
correct.
Owners in Irvington.
Yes.
Okay.
Very good.
I have just one item that I'd like to share. This week last week we began our third cohort of teachers who were being trained in the Understanding by Design framework to help in the curriculum development work that we've been doing. We will have one more cohort after this, which will now include about 70% of our teachers will have gone through this experience and this training. We are anxious and hopeful that we will get to 100%. But 70% is actually a pretty impressive number. So we're pleased. It speaks to our cohesiveness and the collective work that we're doing as an administrative team.
Okay. When would the fourth cohort start?
End of February.
End of February, okay.
And how long is that each training segment?
3 days.
Oh, and 3 days.
So. Tonight, we welcome our administrators, and we're going to have a conversation that we began last year in talking about the work that's going on in our schools and projecting some of the needs that are present in each school. And I think I have to make some comments to kind of paint a picture of our landscape, the financial landscape, that's quite different than it was a year ago. Last year, we were in a position where we anticipated that we would have some opportunity to have some healthy growth within the budget, within the confines of the tax cap. However, this year, we don't have that same kind of luck. It's going to be a very difficult year for us financially. And looking at where we are and what our predicament is, it's, you know, honestly really being driven by the tax cap. So when we look at different factors and different numbers that go into that formula, we look at CPI, the Consumer Pricing Index, which essentially is inflation, which is at a 0.12%. Another important factor of that formula is the tax base growth factor, which is looking at the new properties that come online in the community, the growing of our tax base, and that is at zero. So when we look back the past years, we had some digits in there that worked well for us, and where there was nice growth in the community, there were some new homes, some new businesses that came online, and really inflation was not held back as it has been by our global economy and, of course, what's happening in the United States. So we're in
the growth factor last year, I think, was 1.4%.
Yeah, so and to imagine that being a zero now. And so it's really causing some great difficulty for us. Bev is consistently running the numbers and looking at what those impacts will be for the district. But at the end of the day, as we're finalizing those terms, and I can tell you that State Education Department and the state of New York really does no favors because they constantly keep tweaking things, and as late as the end of the day on Friday, they were revising numbers that they sent to school districts already. But it's going to be a very difficult year. So as my colleagues come to the table in a few moments, you're going to see there's a bit of a different tone than last year. A tone that's going to not only be one that's proud of the work that's going on to tell the story of what's happening in the Irvington schools and to foreshadow the direction we need to go, but at the same time, we may be a little less ambitious in some ways because we know we're going to have a lot of constraints when we get into looking at all the budget details. So with that in mind, we know that the budget process is going to be quite challenging for everyone in our community. And we're going to kind of dial back, and we may have to start looking at reductions, looking at some real challenges and evaluating not only programs and initiatives that we've brought to the table in the last 3 years, but looking at some of those tried and true programs and experiences that our kids have that are very much a part of the Irvington school experience, because we really project this being a difficult process. With that in mind, when we look forward to our budget calendar on February 9th, we are going to have the first half of our budget presented, and then on the 23rd, we are looking at the second component. But we're now evaluating shifting that timeline a little bit and taking advantage of the opportunity on February 9th to actually paint a clear picture of what our finances are and evaluating what our needs are, helping the board and the community understand the challenges that we face. And so that is looking at items such as the tax cap and getting into that deeply and understanding what that means and how we're arriving at the numbers that we're facing, but then also to help understand the growth that's present in our existing budget and the programs and obligations that the district currently holds, and allow that to establish a bit of a new framework for our discussion as we move forward into the other conversations. So we will certainly put together a new timeline for the board, outlining a new sequence of presentations, and then we will communicate that throughout the community. But we think because of the challenges that we face, we have to take a bit of a different approach this year. But that's unfortunately all that I have. But finally, I do just want to say that there's some great things happening in the community with the Spelling Bee coming up this weekend down at the library, and Irvington Rocks in the theater on Saturday at 7 p.m. So we hope everyone comes out and supports those two great organizations. Thank you.
John, will you be in the spelling bee?
My kids almost killed me last year. So.
Well, I somehow got volunteered, so if you want to see someone suffer.
I did it last year. It was, it's fun to do.
I just wanted to say, anybody watching and also PTSA, please tell people to come to the next meeting, the February 9th meeting. Will be very important because that's really the meeting which will lay out in not in the huge detail but in broad strokes about where we stand for this particular budget discussion. And as Dr. Harrison said, it's going to be a series of difficult choices that we have to make as a community, and that meeting will really begin that process in a way that we typically do, which is to make things very clear about the choices that we may have to make as we go through this process. So with that, we want to begin our discussions here with our...
Sure, is that the next item? Right?
Yes, it is.
So I'd like to invite my colleagues to join us around the table. And as we've done in the past, I think it's always valuable for the board members to spread out a little bit.
Anybody want to interact? Sit over here?
Might as well.
Go
right?
For it.
Do I need to take my name tag?
Sure. Oh, wait a minute. There you go.
I'm going to harass her the whole month. Well, maybe I'm pretending to be dead. When they leave, I'll take a soft chair. I know.
Good. So, to begin, I want to thank my colleagues for coming out to spend the evening with us. And as the last few conversations that we've had with the board have been, We've approached the table with a focus, and we've come with some purposeful dialogue and an objective. But we want it to be a free flow of conversation, dialogue where there's exchange among everyone at the table. We make it an experience for all of us to step back and have an opportunity to learn from one another. We've had a theme in our work for a few years now. And when we go back and look at the discussions and the presentations that we had in this room going back 2 and 3 years ago and talking about the work that's happening systemically, it's very clear that we're becoming a very solidified, unified K-12 system. We don't have schools that operate in isolation. We don't have teachers that are doing different things from place to place. We have folks that are sharing their thinking, sharing their talents and their ideas. And I think you'll see an example of that this evening, because the work that my colleagues will so proudly speak of will have a lot of common threads from school to school. And looking at things that are happening in Dow's Lane, you'll see commonalities at the high school. There's been work at the high school that's influenced work at the middle school and Main Street School. So there's a linkage to everything that we do. So across the board, we're looking to expand student experiences, as we've seen through many budget initiatives and new programs that we've brought forth in the last few years. But we've also been really striving to improve instruction, to provide for rigorous learning experiences that meets the needs of all kids, whether that's enrichment in the traditional sense with exciting opportunities for learning, new coursework at the secondary level, or clubs at other levels. We're looking at how we're challenging kids in the classroom on a daily basis through differentiation in the use of technology and unique materials, but also looking at how we're supporting the needs of our struggling learners and everybody in between. So there's a real solid, consistent focus in every single school, and I think it's something that we're proud of. But at the heart of all this is building a solid foundation. And in doing so, I would like to turn to Meg and Deb to be able to talk about the foundation that's being constructed at Dow's Lane, and maybe we can have a little bit of a pun that we'll use foundations as a good kickoff point to highlight some of the work that's been occurring there.
Chris, do we have a microphone for them over there, or how are we going to? Because I think we're bogarting all the microphones over
there.
Yeah.
Why don't we take it right here? So now that you're mic'd.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. It's a pleasure to be first. One of our favorite topics to talk about is Dow's Lane. So thank you, Dr. Harrison, for that introduction, because really the work we want to share about at Dow's Lane is really under the categories of foundational and aspirational. When we speak of foundational, it really is around building a cohesive language by which our students will learn. And with that, I'm going to turn to Meg to really speak to what that cohesive language of learning is about.
So specifically, we're talking about foundations. It's really a lot of the foundational groundwork and phonology for our youngest students. Last year, we began it on KN1, where the students are taught with cohesive language of instruction that follows them up the grades, K1 and 2. And the students are using and really growing in their understanding of the component parts of words, the sounds and letters that make up a word. These skills follow them up through first and second grade. This year we rolled out foundations on second grade, and we're seeing students attack multisyllabic words and then transition into real hardcore word study, where they're going to start looking at prefixes, suffixes, really starting to delve deeply into what makes a word. And this is something, a skill, that will follow them up their years in Irvington. And the language of instruction, when students are being coached by their teachers, they're all coaching using the same language. So we've seen great success with that, and as have our literacy providers.
Yeah. I think what's so foundational about foundations is that it sets students on a trajectory for attacking complex text, which is really what we're looking for them to do with our standards. Teaching for understanding, as Raina has shared for us through our UBD model, the work that we've been doing at Dow's Lane to build a cohesive language of instruction. Teaching for understanding is really about being able to work with teachers and students around their learning.
We look at students with a mindful eye at Dowse Lane, where learning is experiential. And where we're setting the foundation, we're also experiencing and want to create experiences for children, where learning is about creativity, curiosity, and tapping into students as learners, and to spark that passion in them to be learners and what that could mean for them at Dowse Lane. So one of the areas that we are looking so closely at is technology, and really where we want to grow, where technology is not a name of a tool. Technology is an experience. Educational technology is about having students work in a 21st century world and what that can open up for them. I think that what we currently do with PLTW, it is the launch of STEM for students for the first time in third grade, having this in this process design model where they're working with math, technology, engineering, with hands-on, minds-on learning. What we want to do is to keep expanding this, to create experiences for students, to tap into what it means to be a designer, what it means to take their learning to the next level, and to dream about things they've never been able to even dream about. For one of the things we look for is to expand this, but not just to expand PLTW per se, but to expand technology instruction and what that could mean for our students at Dowse Lane, and how we could now build this from third graders with PLTW and second graders with technology in the computer lab, but how we could build a model where by expanding our staff to have a technology, share technology with Main Street School, what that could look like for first graders and for kindergartners. There's the sky's the limit in many of these areas, and it's very, very exciting.
And also another part of teaching for understanding that the teachers have been engaged with is also having students really debate and have meaningful discourse around meatier or weightier topics too. When they put up an essential question, you know, what makes some people worth reading about? And having students engage in accountable talk moves where students are listening and they're really actively listening to each other in order to build on another colleague's point of view when they're talking. We see that with great success in Project Lead the Way as well, where the students have to actually design something and then test it out, and then negotiate which design or redesign they're going to go with next. So it crosses over in multiple environments, whether you're talking about great literature, or you're talking about informational text, or just different points of view working in science or social studies.
So we also look at Dowse Lane as a holistic experience. It's no secret we have our smallest and youngest learners. And what that means to be at Dowse Lane is about being a learner, but also to enjoy the act of learning. And what that means at the early elementary level can simply be magic for our students. So in looking at that, we're also looking at the ways that we're building our school community, what that means to have school spirit at Dowse Lane, what that could mean for us with character building. When we speak about accountable talk, it really is the foundation of how kids learn and grow together. So through our character building initiatives at Dowse Lane and really looking at the character builder framework, how do we pull in our school-wide expectations, our accountable talk, our habits of mind, it really is something that we're gonna hang our hat on. I think for students to have pride and spirit in their Dowse Lane experience will foster a love for learning and really help them to access their learning. If we are only looking on one end of this spectrum in the academia and the high standards, of course we're there. But if students don't want to come to school every day and enhance their own love of learning and learn what it means to be a thinker and have those opportunities to make mistakes and have some grit and learn what it means to be in the muck of learning and what that feels like, Dowse Lane is where we want those experiences to happen. Being at the high school, we know that we don't want to wait. We want them to give those experiences now. So in many of the areas that we're looking to grow at Dowse Lane, it really is around emotional wellness. It's no secret, it's a topic across many of our grade levels, but for our youngest learners, it's not about waiting for someone to show signs of need, it's about what are our tier one, our universal types of things that we do with all students. And looking at our support staff, our school psychologists play a major role in the work that we do at Dowse Lane. And I think for many of us, it's something that we respect the work that they do. We need them, our students need them. And in looking at the structures of Dowse Lane and how our school psychologists are also involved in our preschool
work with CPSE as well as our out-of-district work. We're really looking to build a program where we truly have our two school psychologists to foster experiences for all students in the area of emotional wellness. So one example I could give you is that, you know, carving out time for our school psychologists to actually be in the classrooms, working, you know, in the long term, thinking of what that could look like with the areas of guidance and social work. But one of our school psychologists has been pushing into a third grade classroom around the topic of mindfulness. And the commitment that we made this year was to carve out time in our master schedule for morning meeting. And for our whole school to begin with morning meeting is a time to come together as a building. Mindfulness is a strategy. It's a strategy for students to learn how to be present in their world, to be confident and calm, and to access learning. So it's been so powerful to have time for a school psychologist to do that, and we're looking to increase those types of initiatives so that we can really look at how it's all connected.
Every morning we start with the Pledge of Allegiance, and our new neighbors in district office, I'm sure, look forward to hearing us every day do our announcements, but also to say, you know, what we believe as a community is. As Lane, we are a kind and respectful community. We do our work with pride, persistence, and cooperation. So we've done a lot of teaching into those concepts, those tenets, every morning during morning meeting, and having students cooperate. And what does that look like? What does that sound like? How do you cooperate with somebody if you don't know their name first? Some of these things are foundational things that we all take for granted, but they are actually built at Dallas Lane on a daily basis, and our psychologists play a huge role in that, in partnering with us and with the teachers. Mm-hmm.
So I think overall our experiences at Dallas Lane are meant to be both foundational and aspirational. And really we're looking to enhance what it is that our students come to each and every day, to build their love of learning, to build them to be emotionally healthy, to be able to be ready for the learning that comes next is our ultimate goal. So we thank you.
Thanks. Can we ask some questions? I had two. Mostly relating to capacity in terms of the additional ways that you're thinking about expanding technology in our school psychologists. Do we have the capacity? Do the school psychologists have the capacity to do what you were discussing, which is to spend more time in the classroom working on mindfulness? Is there a capacity issue there? And then I guess secondly, we heard in our last meeting from Jesse and Raina about, Dr. Kaur, about the need for more capacity potentially on the technology side, because we have one teacher that goes back and forth, and just wanted you to address that as well.
Yeah, so I would say that our goal is to build in capacity for them to do this work. If it means something West, we'll build it. I think we are stretched. I think we see the way we are designed now. We have our school psychologists being pulled in many directions. Do they have the personal capacity to bring this to the classrooms? Absolutely. Do they want to? Yes. It's all about being proactive around what it means to be emotionally healthy. A lot of their work is around CSE and around the evaluations and around the work that they need to do with our students of special education, classified students, but the work of a school psychologist can expand that, as well as bringing in other ideas of support. But certainly, yes, we want to build that capacity.
And then on the technology side?
Do you want to speak, or I can?
No.
Okay. So I think currently what we've done to bring in PLTW, we reformatted how we used our technology teacher. So in the past at Dowes Lane, the technology teacher would work in the computer lab and we would create a schedule for all classes to come in. With PLTW being the commitment for third grade, that became their technology component, where we then were able to have the second grade teachers push into the computer lab to co-teach with our technology teacher. That has left now our first grade teachers and our kindergarten teachers with computer lab time. Everybody has a scheduled regular computer lab time. And they work together as colleagues to enhance what that's going to look like and what we want students to know and do. But being able to bring an expert in, a teacher who can co-teach, who can model, who can then help support teachers to bring that technology usage into their classrooms would be ideal to build capacity.
And ultimately, having that technological teacher there builds the capacity of our classroom teachers. There are some things that they have taken upon themselves to do now, old projects, as we talk about the first grade teachers no longer having the support of the technology teacher. They have taken a few things on to their own that they've picked up through the years. But we really also, I think, finding that collaboration and that partnership grows each teacher in their own capacity, too.
So I guess the piece that we are, what the question is, without an increase, then we definitely cannot expand PLTW. So it creates two limitations for us. It creates a limitation of expanding our teachers and our, obviously our students' experience, as well as expanding PLTW. Yeah.
If we expand PLTW, what are we going? What are you going to teach that you don't teach now?
So if we expand PLTW, meaning if we brought PLTW to another grade level?
I mean, I'm confused in this presentation about this being supposed about school needs, what the need is and what you're asking for. Is it more PLTW, more?
A technology teacher.
Okay, fine. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, that wasn't so clear. Yes, so what we're saying is right now we can't.
In Dowes Lane or in between middle school and Main Street?
Between Main Street School and Dowes Lane, I mean, once, if it were feasible and we actually got a second person, we would have to look at a lot of, there are a lot of pieces. So one, we would have to look at where do we want to expand PLTW? Are we looking to do second grade and fifth grade? Do we think we should do K-1, 2? There's a lot of options. So it would depend on where and how we decided to expand PLTW would influence where that person would be.
Okay. I think it would be helpful if we have that discussion to know more specifically what the expansion of the program would look like, what additional things are going to be teaching.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because we've gone back, you know, we've long thought about, you know, our world language needs and extending those down in grades, and it's not at all obvious to me that we want to devote more personnel resources to technology as opposed to something else. And so what we're getting out of that and be able to have an informed discussion about what the trade-offs would be. Mm-hmm. You know, even assuming with our 0.00 whatever tax cap we're going to be able to talk about anything. But.
Mm-hmm. To that point, were there other things that you considered and then decided those were lower priorities, including, for instance, the foreign language that John just asked about? And what were some of those other things that you considered?
Well, I think, I think that there's lots of conversation across mm-hmm. the board. You know, there's nothing that we would not want to expand, right? So if sky's the limit, that's different. But I think mm-hmm. in thinking about what we currently have and what the initiatives were that started last year, and really fostering that to continue makes best sense at this time. I think we want to expand what we've put a lot of work into before we start to think about what could come next. I mean, there's lots of initiatives that don't have to really mean a whole lot of money. There's lots of things that happen at the building level that we're doing because of the work of teachers and enhancing our building. But for this to expand, we really need, that's why the ask is there.
I agree that we've started with something that is working and building upon that model. So we talked about the psychologist pushing in and going into a couple of classrooms to help with morning meeting. Teachers working together and collaborating with them to expand their repertoire. And then also with Project Lead the Way, sitting in on a class of Project Lead the Way is like no other experience where you see students really engaging in real life tasks, and that the whole design process and the inquiry process, how one question leads you to a decision, but might lead you to another question. So for us, seeing those things and seeing that they work and being mindful of the limitations of the budget, moving in that direction seems to be the wisest course.
I guess I would just add to that we're looking at a continuum. So we've built a middle school program. We're expanding on our high school program. So I think it would be incumbent upon us to at least make sure that we have some sort of a consistent, cohesive approach that are preparing our students. I don't think we would just want to start this and do something else in another place. So I think part of our goal here is that continuum of learning and making programs available to our students across the grades and the schools.
I guess I'm still, frankly, confused about what Project Lead the Way is supposed to be giving us in general. But we use the word STEM, but it frankly doesn't make a lot of sense to me to use that term. Because the M and the S are, we teach separately, math and science.
Part of, well,
Joyce will talk to you.
And technology is the computer stuff. The E, I don't know what that is and why we're teaching it.
The engineering?
Yeah. You know, given that you look at a good college engineering program, and what they're looking for is science and math. They're not looking for, you know, secondary level engineering.
And I certainly would be glad to.
I guess I'm just after a little clarity about what.
Yeah, and then we certainly could. We certainly could provide.
Joyce's wish, when Joyce talks about Main Street, maybe she's going to expand on that. That might be helpful.
My turn.
Yeah. Well, I have a question. Can you just remind us which grades have PLTW classes?
So third grade and fourth grade have PLT. And so when we say, right, PLTW is Project Lead the Way. So
Project
it doesn't mean
way.
That we don't have other things in other grades, but Project Lead the Way is in third, in fourth, in seventh, and then at the high school. So when we committed to Project Lead the Way, last year we wrote a grant, and we got the grant. The grant is a two-year grant. To run Project Lead the Way at the middle school, we are required to run two foundational courses, Designs and Modeling, which is the course that we ran this year, and next year is Robotics. And that's our commitment. As far as elementary school, the launch program, we have flexibility. We can do a variety of things, and certainly at the high school, we're committed to the engineering sequence. There's a computer science sequence, there's a biomedical science sequence, neither of which right now we're committed to.
Okay. And with foundations, is it, now that we've extended to second grade, is that where it stops, or do we, okay.
So our decision. But one of the things we were talking about before, things that we hope to continue that are not a huge add-on to our budgetary process, foundations is one of them. So we started with K and one, we increased to grade two, and now what we're doing is supporting that through the years, keeping our commitment to kindergarten, first and second grade. We started talking about what would the transition for the third grade require, what kinds of techniques or strategies or the cohesive language would the third grade teachers need to be familiar with that are not a huge cost to us. Also, how it informs our thinking is that we're looking at the cohorts as they're coming up. So the current second graders have had 2 years in a sequence of foundations. Our current first graders, when they enter second grade, will be the cohort that experienced it all the way through, kindergarten, first grade, second grade. And to keep watching that data and seeing how it impacts the students, not just in how they decode and encode words and language, but also how does that impact their comprehension? How are they able to access deeper text and understand things on another level because their minds are free and they're not working so hard to decode all the words? So that's something that we're continuing that's not a huge expense to us next year.
That means maybe a consultant to help work with the teachers, or does that mean something else?
It would be continue to coach the teachers and then obviously the refills for the consumable parts of the kit.
Yeah, I think the whole thing wasn't a big budget item. There was something, and when it got introduced to another grade, there was some consultant that had to be brought. Mm-hmm. That's a one-off.
But for Project Lead the Way, that was an aspect that we have, I guess, one set of materials enough for a class, and in the future it would be desirable to have enough for each class?
I'm sorry, Michael, go ahead.
No, that was it.
So Project Lead the Way is far more complex. As we're making these decisions about how to move forward, so for example, there are some Project Lead the Way units that would align with the Next Gen Science Standards. So one of the conversations we had was, as we're going to have to realign our science program, possibly doing some of our Project Lead the Way units in the classroom. So teachers are doing those units, which would free up our technology teachers to work more on the computer science strand. If we went that route, though, we would then have to expand and have enough materials for six or seven classrooms at a given time. Now, we may have to do that anyway, because as we expand our science program, we did that now. They're called FOSS kits, so we buy kits. We haven't bought those in many years at this point, but the Next Gen Science Standards, there's no question for not next school year, but the following school year, will definitely have some demands on as far as budget, because we're going to have to revamp our science program, and that's actually going to have an effect, definitely K-5, but it'll also have some spillover at 6-8 as well.
And then right now, the person who's doing Project Lead the Way in Dows is also in the middle school. Is that the same person?
Main
Street School?
I'm sorry, that's the technology teacher.
Yes. Right, Gwen Corn. Yeah.
So
to be clear, the ask is for one psychologist and a tech teacher that you share with Main Street, or?
No, my ask was for a shared technology teacher with Main Street School, but there is actually no ask as in terms of a position. The two psychologists exist. What we're working with, am I correct with PP?
Well, no, it's a part of a position.
It's the position.
We're increasing the position.
Yes.
At Dow's Lane, because the person has additional duties besides Dow's Lane. So what we'd like to do is have more commitment at Dow's Lane, which would be.
She would be full-time. Right now, the person at Dow's Lane, well, why don't I let Scott or Gail answer?
So what we've talked about is realigning our existing psychologist by adding that half-time psychologist to fill out the half-time position we had last year to a full-time position would allow each of our psychologists to be more present in their individual buildings instead of being spread between buildings and losing time in travel and services to kids while the Main Street psychologist is up on the campus dealing with our two self-contained classes that they support. They can stay at Main Street and do some out-of-district work, which they could do while they're still at Main Street School. The Dow's Lane psychologist who's currently doing that work wouldn't have to do that work so that she could be more present at Dow's Lane. So it would allow us, all of our psychologists, to be more efficient and be located more succinctly and more substantially in one building rather than being spread between.
I think the one piece of this that's missing from our discussion is looking at the significant needs and the new types of needs that we're seeing in our schools. And while they're being, we're seeing increased needs for psychological support at all of our schools, really there's been a massive impact at Dow's Lane. So I don't know if you want to speak to that a little bit.
Well, in all the schools, really, we're seeing emotional factors that are becoming more and more pronounced in our students at all grade levels. I think they are the most obvious at Dow's Lane in that young kids act out their emotional difficulties differently than do kids at older grade levels. So it becomes fairly obvious, but we're definitely seeing those indications and the need for further emotional support. So the additional half psychologist this year was a huge help at the high school. We're much better able to address those needs at the high school, although still experiencing that influx. And the social worker that we added has been a huge aspect in not only working in front, but behind the scenes to support families, remove barriers that aren't even obvious to us up front or obvious to the public, so to speak.
Are you saying that our use of the number of kids who need psychological services is growing?
Yes.
Absolutely.
And why is that?
Not just here.
It's not just here.
Not just
all
here.
Of my colleagues are talking about that.
Countrywide. Or studies.
Why is
yeah, studies out of John Hopkins and Duke.
What's going on that's causing that? Is it an increase in diagnosis of problems, or are there really more problems?
No, there really appears to be more problems. I think there are many theories out there as to what's causing it, but I don't know if it's been actually determined what it is, whether it's rising standards in kids that are more stressed out. Is it because of the stress that we're doing culturally with our kids? We don't know.
Environmental.
But what we're in environmental.
Yeah.
What we're seeing, though, is the kids, regardless of whether we've been able to pinpoint the reason behind the influx here. And it's not just an Irvington phenomenon. All my colleagues in Westchester are talking about it, and really it's a nationwide effect that's being seen.
Not just Westchester.
Correct.
No.
So and this is over what, the last 5 years?
I think it's been growing over the last 5 years. It's become really acute in the last 2 years.
So you're talking about kids coming in, not necessarily if it's in the last 2 or 3 years, is the kids coming in, or is it kids in, say, third or fourth grade that are in greater need than they were 2 or 3 years ago?
Both. Some kids develop in our students here. We've also had an influx.
Right. All right.
So,
Joyce?
So, Joyce, do you want to build upon the foundation that Dow's set for you?
So, good evening, everyone. Dr. Harrison, Dr. Kaur, members of the board. I'm going to start by just sharing, you know, some of the work that happened at Main Street School as a result of the board support from last year's budget and how that extends into where we want to go at Main Street School moving forward. interestingly, well, it connects to how Dr. Harrison opened this evening, you're going to hear a lot of the common language that Deb and Meg referred to as they talked about the experience at Dow's Lane, and I just started taking notes and boxing all of the commonalities of things that you're going to hopefully hear as I share about what happens at Main Street School. So Project Lead the Way, so we were really fortunate to have the support to bring this new program to our school this year. And so in doing that, Gwen Carney, our technology teacher, shifted from teaching technology only to being our Project Lead the Way shared teacher with Dow's Lane. And the work of Project Lead has provided students with opportunities to think about what does it mean to be a designer, but it's also given them an experience to sort of live out our district goals and theory of action. So our kids have opportunities to communicate effectively and problem solve and think critically in a project-based environment. It's a different way, it's a different entry point for learning for our kids. You know, it's a different setup in the classroom. It's group-based, so everything's collaborative. So our kids are learning to apply so much of the work that we teach explicitly in the classroom. They're now having an opportunity to transfer in a different setting, which is really exciting for us to see. As a building, we work on accountable talk, similar to what Dow's Lane. You know, that's just explicitly teaching kids how to have productive discussions where they extend their thinking and build on the thinking of one another, using specific language to demonstrate that they're actively listening and to go deeper so that they are getting to a deeper understanding of whatever it is that they're discussing. And so Project Lead the Way is a place for that. And so what last year I talked about the benefits of having Christine Reiser as the math coach, but what we've seen this year, because Christine went to training with Gwen Carney, we've actually benefited from having our math coach participate, because I think you referenced it earlier, John, was about where math fits in. And so Christine's able, through her work with Gwen and unpacking the modules, to identify the mathematical concepts that connect to Project Lead the Way and where they come in our math modules, so that it reinforces it. She's able to reinforce with our teachers those concepts, so we close the loop for our kids so that they know that those math concepts are happening in Project Lead the Way and reinforced in the classroom and vice versa, which has been tremendous. I would say that we're also now discovering with the New York State adoption of the Next Gen Standards, we're trying to see, you know, where Project Lead the Way modules fit in, and Raina mentioned this earlier, with what science units we are doing. And so as we move forward with Project Lead the Way, we're going to be considering, you know, what science units are we going to be doing in our classrooms, and what Project Lead the Way, and if we're able to expand Project Lead the Way, what modules will happen and where that will fall. And for us at Main Street School, this year we started Project Lead the Way at third grade and fourth grade simultaneously, but what's really exciting is next year we will have this cohort of kids who live through Project Lead the Way as third graders, and we're going to have this opportunity to see, you know, the growth. They're going to come in at a very different point. What, you know, just their understanding of the collaborative nature. You know, while technology is in the title of the STEM and of Project Lead the Way, so much of the work, you know, not every lesson incorporates technology. We incorporate iPads as part of the program, but so much of it is the thinking and the design work and the planning and the collaboration with kids before they even get to the technology. You know, they're building using VEX kits and, you know, coming up with a plan and deciding what's their design and why is their design like that. They're learning how, like, when you start something, you do it. It doesn't always come out the way you intended to, and using data, you can go back and you can figure out how to rework it. We talk about wanting our kids to know it's okay to make mistakes and that we want them to persist and go back and try again. Project Lead the Way provides this opportunity every time the kids go to it. So another place at Main Street School where we benefit from the budget from last year was in our support of students. So Response to Intervention, or RTI, which is our system for delivering support for our struggling learners. Really the foundation of it is just quality instruction in the classroom, which we call Tier 1 interventions, which you heard Deb and Meg reference. And so this year, because of a clearly articulated plan and support from the district, we are able to provide learning for our teachers at Tier 1. And so at the classroom level, our teachers are implementing Tier 1 interventions so that we're getting to our kids at their individual needs. But with the addition of the math AIS teacher at Main Street School, we were able to get more flexibility with how we deliver it, whether it's with the frequency or the duration. For the kids, we don't have to give all kids the same amount. We're giving kids what they need when they need it in math, in a much better way than we were previously without that additional support. In addition, this year we're piloting a universal screener as part of our response to intervention, and that also is going to give us information and data on students with pilot classes that they'll look at the data, and that will help us identify what support we need to provide for students. You know, where some kids might need 5 days a week for 30 minutes, some kids might need 3 days a week, you know, for 30 minutes, and then other kids might just need a touch-base experience. So we're building on the work, great work at Dowsing that they've been doing for the past several years on response to intervention. We're really just getting on board at Main Street School, and the math support increase really helped us to do that.
And Joyce, just a quick question. Universal screener is like a quick test or a
Yeah, I wouldn't put the word quick. I would say teachers administer a universal screener to all students in their classrooms. And there are multiple tests. They each have a different time allotment and have a different purpose. So there's a math and there's an ELA. Some for ELA, it might comprehension, fluency, you know, all of the things that we expect related to reading. And then for math, similarly. And then we take that data. And so it's new for us, Phil. I actually haven't seen it yet. We're just piloting it. So once we get to that, I would have more information on specifics of what is on their universal screener. We're just in the piloting phase, which is coming up in the next few weeks.
And that's to screen people for needs for intervention?
All students.
All students.
So yes, because it will give us information about all kids, like where they're doing well and also where they're struggling and need support. So all kids will be screened. And this is the first time we'll have something that is consistent, you know, in this meaning it's normed, right? Is that what it is, Marina? It's normed. So it's our first.
And it serves as a benchmark?
Yes.
And over time, you would do it 3 times during the course of the year so that you're always able to go back in and benchmark your students to see, are they on par? Are they growing at the rate that you would expect the level of growth? Are there students who mid-year we should be picking up that either became more sluggish in their learning, so they were fine in September, but now they require that intervention? It gives us data that we can actually use and refer to, and again, universally, across K through 5, so it's not just happening in one place, it's the way we do business, it's the way that we know what our students know and what our students need.
But is it different from what you always used to do with growth scores, or
Well, when you say growth scores, you're talking about the New York State Assessment when you say that?
I am.
Well, so the New York State Assessment starts in third grade.
Right.
So we have no, and the New York State Assessment is not a universal screener. So in other words, when I say that, it's not an assessment that is given to all students to determine where they are and what they need. It's an assessment that's created by New York State somewhat arbitrarily and without consistency from one grade to the next. So you can't really use it as a measurement tool. It gives us other information, but it's not a consistent measure.
It also changes every year. So
that's what I mean.
Right.
It's not designed to.
Right.
Is it, if I Google it, is it universal screener or is there another?
Yeah. Okay. Can I continue? Okay. I think also through the universal screener, what teachers will get is for their tier one interventions back that they'll know, you know, we'll be able to provide suggestions and information about how to support the kids where they are and what they need. And again, like Raina said, over time those needs will change and our support will change to will reflect that. So at Main Street School, character building is the heart of everything that we do, really. And you've heard that over and over again. Just similarly to Dow's Lane, you know, we explicitly teach into the habits of mind, and kids work through habits of mind. You know, they consider what habits of mind they need to be successful at various tasks across their day. We address these through morning meeting, but also through all academic areas. It flows into the special area classes with it in the recess, in the hallways, in the cafeteria. Everybody is using a common language. So similar to what Dow's Lane said, that consistency of language is huge for students. They know what to expect when we use that same language. It also affords a smoother transition for the kids from third to fourth to fifth grade in Irvington. We have monthly assemblies, and as a result of work last year around global citizenship, you know, our character building and our global citizenship go hand in hand. And so if we want to have our students at Main Street School be citizens of our community through our habits of mind and our character building and the framework questions, you know, we also want them to be citizens of the world. And so that connects to the work. We have a think tank on global citizenship that many teachers are a part of, and we meet to just process our own understanding of what it means to be a global citizen and what are the ways in which we can provide those experiences for kids in the classroom, whether it's reading articles or the texts we choose, conversations we're having, the content of our assemblies that we have, you know, always framing with the character building questions that Deb and Meg refer to: what is fair, what is community, what is ownership, how is an action action, and what defines who we are, consistently frames the work that we do around character building at Main Street School. And so connected to the global citizenship, we have this, we have the district technology plan. So our building level committee this year took the focus of goal 7, which is global citizenship. And through that work, we have a cohort of teachers along with Jesse Lipinski, and we've identified projects that connect kids globally using technology. So whether it's supporting something in ELA, it could be a mystery hangout with someone, a class did one connected to science. We spoke to meteorologists all over Texas yesterday through a Skype, and there were 3 or 4 classes on, it wasn't Skype, it was Google Hangout. On Google Hangout, we have classes Skyping. We have teachers connecting with projects like service learning projects in other countries with, or other classrooms, you know, in our area, in our nation and around the world. We've also, and so the goal 7, you know, has been big for us because the technology plan, we think about the ways in which we can make, we can actually articulate how it's playing out at our building. And so goal 7 is playing out with the support of Jesse and the cohort, and it's teachers who, you know, have a passion for technology and want to bring it to the classroom and bring it to their kids. We also, the accountable talk work connects to, similar to what Deb and Meg said and I said earlier, connects to the theory of action and being a citizen, about being an effective communicator or problem solver. You need all those life skills. You need to interact as a citizen. You know, all the content is really important, but we want our kids to process it in a way that helps them transfer, or we want them to transfer. And finally, this year, something that the board supported was the social worker. So Gina Menendez, I know it's been a K-12 impact, but it's been tremendous at Main Street School to have an additional support person. She's been an asset to the students, the teachers, the parents, to our community. She, you know, she works at Main Street, she works in all the buildings, but at Main Street School, she sits on our committees and fosters the work and makes connections building to building. She also gets, you know, she's also connecting with families and making the experiences at Main Street School the best that they can be for many of our students who without that resource wouldn't have the same experience. So I'm just going to shift to how we've fostered this year then extends into where we want to head moving forward at Main Street School. So we have opportunities at Main Street School, but we're looking to expand those opportunities for students. And so this year we were able to have additional we got additional club money, but we also added additional club money through PTSA and through grants through the IEF. And so we were able to have two garden clubs, 4th and 5th grade, which is helping to actually get us a garden at Main Street School. We are fundraising and working to build a garden to create that continuity from Dowd's Lane that has a garden and the middle school that has a garden. Main Street School doesn't. And so we want a place that sort of bridges that experience for our students. It would be a mindful garden, which fosters, you know, the work that we're doing around mindfulness as well at Main Street School. So kids have written me letters this year about wanting comic book club and writing club and a reading club. I mean, the ideas come from the kids, and oftentimes we have to be creative about how we can provide those experiences without it being an official club. And so sometimes we can't do it, and sometimes we're able to. We can tuck them into another club and find how that works. But we are looking for what other opportunities. And so Destination Imagination, last year we were fortunate to have the PTSA fund 2 4th grade teams. This year IEF has graciously funded 8. We are able to have 8 teams, but that is because we expanded to having parent team managers. So as a district, I feel like the response, at least for 4th and 5th grade, has been tremendous about the excitement around Destination Imagination. And for those of you who don't know what Destination Imagination is, it's an opportunity for students to participate in a collaborative problem-solving experience where they compete. So they do what's called instant challenges and central challenge. They work over the course of from the beginning of the school year until March. First weekend in March is the competition. It's a tournament at Mercy. Students along the way, they go to a fiesta where they practice instant challenges, which an instant challenge could be, they get a challenge that they have a time limit. So it could be like there's a fan blown, you have to put the fan on high, blow the balloon up, you have a straw, a toilet paper roll, two paper clips, and a rubber band, figure out how to get the balloon to stand up straight and not go more than 45 degree angle. I mean, they're amazing, these challenges. The kids get them, they've never seen them before. And because they've practiced as a team and worked to develop those skills that we've talked about, all those dispositions, they have an opportunity to put them into place. And they work with their same team members, up to seven kids on a team. Twice a week now they meet during lunch, and they meet after school. And additionally, many of the team managers have put in additional meetings so that the kids can work together. The central challenge is a challenge that they work on consistently from the start of the school year until March, where they present it at the tournament. There are what they call appraisers. Praise are not judges, because they give kids praise. They give them feedback on how they're working. And depending on where kids place, there's opportunities for a tournament in Binghamton. And then depending on that, there's an opportunity for an international experience that's held in Tennessee. So it is an international organization, and the feedback is great. So we are looking for sort of shifting the model and looking for, you know, more of how we can build it into sixth grade and start to build it up through the grades so it takes root in Irvington. There isn't a similar, you know, sort of club experience, and kids have really, it's been really positively received by both parents and students. So what other student experiences? When we think about our global citizenship and just citizenship, we think about the service learning. We are about to venture into a partnership with the Green Policy Task Force. That's the Green Policy Task Force. Sorry, there's so many things to share. So quickly, recycling program. I was watching the clock for the time limit to balance their time. But I'll quick hurry up. Recycling partnership, which we bringing in an outside group that we want to work on to reduce all of the waste in the cafeteria. We would be the first school in the district. We would be the model for then transitioning other schools in our district at going to that model. We have Irvington High School students working with us and the Irvington Garden Club, so it's an opportunity to bring everybody in the community together. I'll just say a couple more things. The back to the student support, and we were talking about response to intervention. So while we had support with additional math support last year, it would be helpful to have additional support so that we could increase the flexibility around response to intervention. And then also, I know Deb and Meg spoke a lot about the technology teacher, which I can reiterate everything that they said. Because of Project Lead the Way and the experience that we've had, Gwen has been pulled away from what she had done integrating technology previously. And so while Meg mentioned that, you know, teachers could, some of them can do it in their classrooms, you know, I really think that we need to consider, like, what we want from a technology integration teacher and what's possible for that person to work K-5. Once we decide where we're going with how Project Lead the Way, we'll expand that, we'll inform where we need that person. But the need is there, and it's one that we should look into. And that would be it.
Sure. Do you need more time, Joyce?
No, that's okay. If there are questions, I might get to some of the
information. To be fair, she was very short last year, so.
I was, because it was so long first that I decided I should watch the clock. It's okay. I feel like I got a lot out.
You sure did.
You could talk faster next time.
Yeah. You should hear me read the leaves at a character building assembly.
I have a couple questions.
Sure.
A general question. The next gen science standards, are those scheduled now, or is it still this the standards of the future, and the future keeps receding?
So New York's done some nice things. They are moving forward. They've edited the next gen science standards to make them New York science standards. They've actually created some pretty nicely written evidence statements. So what would be evidence of the learning of these standards? How will we know if students are meeting those standards? I believe the expectation is they'll be voted on in March.
Voted on by the Regents.
And so I think we are all keeping our fingers crossed that they will at least be adopted, and then we would probably start maybe some work this summer, but really our work would be throughout next year.
And this would be in a change in the, mostly in the K through five? Or
K-12.
Even 12?
All science courses would be reflected in the next gen science standards. So again, I think sometimes we're driven, you know, it depends what you might argue we're driven by.
Right.
So if we're driven by a New York State assessment, currently our New York State assessment of science is in fourth grade and eighth grade, and then any regions courses we offer. So we would have to talk about what does it mean to integrate the science standards.
Yeah, I think we'd have to have a very serious talk about what we want for high school programs.
The science standards are really well designed.
I know, but there's, you know, all the needs of colleges. College science that doesn't change just because the New York State Regents vote on something. We need to be careful about that. Okay, so that's the timing of that's uncertain. Is there something, anything you can share with the board about what they're working on? Paper or links or something like that?
Of the next gen science standards? Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, if you Google next gen science standards, you get, it's a very comprehensive, I'm happy to send you the links.
Something a little less comprehensive.
Not so easy. not so simple.
Also, the other question is, and this is an elementary question. Where are we on enrichment pullouts? You know, because we had the math enrichment that got changed to something else. I don't even know if we ever had it on the reading side, but we were concerned over time about whether getting rid of enrichment reduced the opportunities for some of our kids, and I don't know where we are on that. Is there any sense of that?
I think you asked that question last year in this very same setting, and I remember.
I missed this meeting. It would have been in a budget.
Then it would have been a different meeting.
I watched it on TV, but
You didn't watch yourself ask that question.
Yeah, I would never do that.
So we don't have pullouts for enrichment. Mm-hmm. And if you were talking specifically about math, you know, our math modules are designed in a way to support, you know, all levels of learners. So the way that our problem sets, you know, tier, you know, there are opportunities for every student. So our teachers differentiate in the classroom, provide that, whether it's support for a struggling learner or it's, mm-hmm. you know, enrichment for a non-struggling student, you know, they have all avenues based on what we're using in the classroom now for math.
And are you getting any feedback? And this would probably be more likely to come up in fourth and fifth than in the earlier grades. Are you getting any feedback from parents about their comfort or lack of comfort with what they're...
Related to enrichment?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
I haven't had
so
any.
So you aren't getting the kind of it concerns...
No, because
people had back in, you know.
No, because of the modules, because of the way they're designed and what they're demanding of students, you know, and
yeah.
I think it's also being supplemented though by other enriching experiences such as different destination imagination, and there's other enriching opportunities and Project Lead the Way that kids' learning is being challenged and extended in so many other ways that it's just not happening in a single little pullout period that would happen once in a while. It's happening across the board in every classroom.
Any questions, Catherine, Michael?
Mm-hmm. So, middle school, and you know, certainly there's those connections that have been built already. Some conversation around destination and imagination, as well as technology and the like, for you to build upon the themes that have been generated.
So we'll try to do this before the music starts playing.
or commercial break.
you know, I think it goes without saying for all of our schools, but you know, specifically talking about the middle school, we often talk about a focus on the whole child. We talk about trying to create an experience for students that addresses their needs across the different dimensions of who they are, whether that's academic or social or physical or emotional. And, you know, so some of the things that were said earlier that I won't go into great depth talking about in the interest of time, but that certainly resonate with that is this idea of having a common language of learning. You know, Deb mentioned that, and it really did resonate with some of the comments that Allison and I had talked about in preparing for this evening and thinking about what we're doing right now and where we're looking to go. And really promoting a learning experience that is experiential. The work of our of our school for several years now has been really trying to focus on creating the opportunity and the expectation for students to engage in really divergent questioning, divergent thinking, in the midst of really challenging content. And so teachers have worked on that a great deal. They've worked on it collaboratively. They've worked on it within their departments, within their grade levels, and so forth. One of the really wonderful things that's been happening this year in a new way for us is the involvement of our Library Media Center in that process. We are in our first year with a new library media specialist who came to us last summer and has really, I think, reminded us of some things we already knew, but also opened our eyes to some new opportunities in terms of what our library can be as the hub of instruction, as a place to really expand upon the work that our teachers are doing in all sorts of content, across content areas, pardon me. We've talked a lot about the importance of literacy as it relates to all sorts of all of the disciplines. We've talked in this room about that, in fact, and so it's no surprise that our new librarian has really jumped in with both feet, worked with a tremendous number of teachers to really expand upon the impact that the Library Media Center is having as those teachers are trying to meet the needs of students relative to literacy, the Common Core standards, their own content, and really trying to bring all of those together. It's an example of adult collaboration that is opening new horizons for students, and it's something we're very excited about. We're hoping as we go forward, and I'm going to be pretty direct about this in terms of a request, we're hoping to take that opportunity and really have it grow. What we've known for a long time is that we're understaffed in our Library Media Center. What we're seeing this year is that understaffing is an opportunity for us to grow a growing program in a way that will have real meaningful impact in our classrooms. There are a number of other impacts that this proposal can have, and I'll get to those in a little while, but I know Allison's going to talk a little bit about some of the work that's ongoing relative to the Library Media Center, Library Media Specialist, and some opportunities as we go forward.
So we're really excited to sort of talk about all of the work that's been happening in and beyond our library, I think that's benefiting both the middle and the high school this year. So when David and I were preparing, we sort of thought across three different ways with some concrete examples to sort of illustrate to you the power, the impact, how this library media specialist role has really enhanced and enriched our curriculum across the disciplines. So one of the more obvious ways is the role has allowed and afforded her the opportunity to work with teachers and students and matching resources to fit their needs. So an example from earlier in the fall when she was just forging her relationships with our colleagues was teachers would go to her and ask her for resources. So an example was a seventh grade classroom was the teacher wanted to have the students engage in a text-based discussion. They were studying slavery. And her quandary was that many of the primary and secondary documents and articles that she would, you know, want students to read were not appropriate to their reading level, et cetera. And so working in conjunction with the library media specialist, she was able to identify an array of texts that were appropriate and that had built-in scaffolds. So they were rigorous, yet there was like a feature of chunking to help students that, you know, might need more support and scaffold accessing the text. I was actually fortunate enough to sort of reap the benefits of all that collaboration and was in this particular social studies classroom during a period and see the small group and then those small group discussions forge into a whole class discussion, again, as a result of these rich texts that she had found with the support of the library media specialist. Another example is our sixth grade social studies department this year really wanted to expand the notion of current events. They, in the past, had an isolated unit, and they really wanted students being aware and learning about current events across the school year. And so part and parcel was that was finding appropriate websites and different types of multimedia that students could access individually, with a partner, in school and at home. And so the library media specialist went in and provided lessons in the different social studies classroom to build that independence for the students. her role has evolved as she's sort of developed relationships with our teachers over time, so, and with our students. And this literally, one of our ELA teachers mentioned to me today that she has two students in one of her sections that are a bit more reluctant to read. They have difficulty finding books for independent reading, and sometimes if they find a book, they tend to abandon those books. So one really needs to put a lot of effort in to match them to a book that they're going to stick with and ultimately enjoy and be a passionate reader about. And she said that these two young boys actually went on their own during lunch because they know the library media specialist because she's been in their classroom working with their teacher, and went on their own during lunch and recess and found books that now they're committed to reading. So I thought that was a nice example of, you know, working with classes, but then also building that relationship with students. So students are coming into the library before school, after school, et cetera, and feeling like there's someone in there who can and will and wants to ultimately support them. So beyond matching resources, something that David mentioned that we're really committed to at the secondary level is this whole notion of supporting students in research and research across the content areas. Particularly, you know, in ELA and social studies, we have a host of examples of our library media specialist co-planning and co-teaching lessons in our classroom. I will give you another example. I spontaneously went into a classroom on Friday for an informal visit, and when I walked in, the library media specialist was working with two students. The teacher was conferring with another student. They had just, in a previous class, learned about all the different databases that they would be using to research an historical figure that they had each chosen from the time period of the American Revolution, and trying to figure out what was the impact of that person in that time period. And the library media specialist had not only introduced and reviewed databases for them, she had then taken it upon herself to build a Google Doc where she had put resources that reflected and targeted their specific topics. And then also, students were remotely like asking her questions for further support. So it was such a powerful model. It was like an ICT classroom in that she was really, and this is ongoing. This was, you know, she will continue to be in that classroom supporting those students as they grapple with this is their first, you know, in-depth research project. And I just wanted to read something that this teacher actually wrote in her reflection that I got tonight right before this board meeting that I thought was so powerful. And this is about the library media specialist. She wrote, "She provides a 21st century library experience that is refreshing and relevant to today's student research needs." So that kind of encapsulates it. And then the last thing that just kind of builds upon what David said is, she's also really worked, she has a short-term and a long-term plan that we're working on as a secondary team with Dr. Kaur and Dr. Harrison about our vision for the library, both aesthetically and physically. And I feel like the library, you might even get a sense now as you're walking through, is very much a vibrant and engaging environment that students feel comfortable coming to. And again, just one recent example, our sixth grade, you're familiar with our Jacob Burns project that they do for visual media, and when they were launching it, she reconfigured the library to build a little amphitheater so we could have a bunch of classes come at one time and work with the liaison from Jacob Burns, which gave students more time with that expert because he didn't have to go to individual classes. So I thought that that was a really, you know, great example. So just thinking ahead, you know, our request, our hope is to be able to have another library media specialist, and we know that there's a lot of untapped potential for what that position could bring in addition to what's already happening. But we definitely feel, and I think Dave and Steve would agree, we could do a lot more, because the one, I guess, worry we have right now is when she's working with a class or a teacher who's also wanting to work with her, and we know her calendar is very filled. Full, so.
And I could, if I would just add 10 seconds of history on that, which is when the middle school moved to the campus, that was supposed to bring another full-time library media specialist to the campus. There was a recognition that we really need two library media specialists if we're really going to support really over 1,000 students. And so, it, obviously, we did not get that at the time.
So actually, that's exactly where I was just about to go, is just, you know, and I didn't frame that part of it in my initial comments, but it's important for us to say that out loud, that we have one person serving the role of library media specialist with one aide meeting, trying to meet the needs of some 1,000 students, 100 teachers that range in ages from 11 to 18.
Yeah.
And so thinking about that, that's a big deal. First of all, that's a lot more than we would ask of any library in any other building in our district. If you look at other districts where there is a shared high school, middle school campus, the most common model is for there to be not only two library media specialists, but also additional support, you know, in the form of either aides, teaching assistants, or what have you. So, you know, what we've known for a while that we don't have a lot of staff in the library. What we've experienced this year with a new person in the district is a growth in enthusiasm that is only limited by the time that's available for this one person, and we'd like to build upon. Just getting back to this idea of that language of learning, that language in the library and for so many of our students beyond their classrooms is this idea of being information literate, of being able to acquire, be discerning about and utilize information from a variety of sources and in a variety of ways. I would say that we are growing at this point and really on the cusp of real movement in our library. We're already having real movement in our library and media center. We're on the cusp of something much, much bigger with some additional resources in that regard, something we're very excited about and believe very strongly in the potential of. What's always nice is when you can present a proposal that addresses a real need, but then also can address multiple other needs right along the way. And that's something that I think is unique about this particular one. This is while it's a middle school request and it's where it's being initially generated from, it really is something that has a campus-wide benefit, or potentially has a campus-wide benefit, both as a shared library media center and then some other ways. One of the things at the middle school level that would be a natural fit for a new library media specialist's duties, in addition to being in the library, would be in the area of our study skills program. Study skills is a program that our sixth graders take part in as part of their transition to the middle school. And one of the things that we see happening here is part of the duties of a new library media specialist being in leading that program, and both in, you know, teaching really basic study skills that we know students need to acquire as they move from a single classroom to a multi-classroom day, 8-9 different teachers, classes, and subject areas. But then also building in a real meaningful research component. It's something that we've made attempts at over time, but we've also had a lot of turnover in the study skills program over time. And so to me, and I think, you know, it's clear, there's a natural fit between a person that serves in the role of a library media specialist and not just the study skills, but the idea of research, the idea of questioning, the idea of really being able to utilize, to acquire and utilize information in a really effective way. That will benefit all of our students as they enter the middle school and then have carry-on effects as they get into 7th and 8th grade and continue down that research path. Obviously, they are doing that when they come to the middle school, but, there's more to come, and there's an incredible growth that comes about from that intense work with someone in that role. I actually have some experience with a library information course for 6th graders from a prior district. It is something that is quite an opportunity, both for 6th graders and then for those same students as they get on into 7th and 8th grade. The next carry-on effect for that is that presently we have one of our technology teachers teaching most of our study skills program. And so not only do we see perhaps a more appropriate and successful fit for a study skills program, but now we have concurrently freed up staffing for the purposes of expanding technology instruction. And so for us at the middle school, that would be perhaps additional offerings in the area of Project Lead the Way. That could be continuation of a course that we've just begun today in computer programming, an accelerated computer programming course that some of our eighth graders have begun to take.
There's a number of different opportunities, but I'd also say, as I mentioned a moment ago, that this is a campus-wide position, a new library media specialist, and we see potential for growth at the high school as well, because we are a system, and we are looking to build experiences in the middle school, much as Joyce mentioned, building experiences in Main Street School that grow into the middle school. We are looking to build experiences that will put students in good shape to continue those experiences at the high school. So we see a lot of bang for the buck here with one position. We see three different areas of our program positively affected. And so, you know, we're pretty excited about the opportunity. Obviously, we know what the budgetary implications look like this year, but at the same time, when there's an opportunity like this, we think it's worth pursuing. And so that's the main point for our middle school this year. There's one other request, and it feels a little bit like a non sequitur now, because I feel like it's not tied to the library, although it will affect students that use the library. For many years, the middle school had a late bus run, and I feel like it's now been 6 years since we had that opportunity for students to stay after school and have transportation home. And we know that there's been a growth in our district of two-income families, two working parent families, where transportation to and from school is not so easy, and for some that's not a big deal. Students can walk. For many in our district, that walk is a difficult one. So I do offer. I know that the transportation budget is somewhat separate from many of the things we're talking about tonight, but it is something that we at the middle school have said. Not only are there students every year who are limited in their ability to take advantage of things we currently offer after school, whether that's homework center, access to the library, some of the clubs that do meet after school, but it also places a limitation on new items that we might want to offer after school, because we know that there's going to be some segment of our population that can't access them or will have difficulty accessing them. So that is really the secondary piece that we offer tonight. So thank you.
And the late bus, it would just be a single bus run for the...
In the past, it's a one bus run. It was actually two buses, one that went north and one that went south, and kind of did a modified version of
two buses. It'd be two buses, two drivers.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's one bus time, I guess, is the way I was thinking of it. Right. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Two.
Yes.
Yes.
Two actual buses.
And would this also serve the high school?
Good. Sure. Of course.
Sure.
Same time.
Yeah. And actually, some of the high school students are...
high school students would take it, but that's an issue we have sometimes.
They
students would actually take it, absolutely.
Yeah.
I think they would.
We already have some high school students that
take the middle school buses.
Whether they take them in classes.
But this would be shared between high school and middle school.
It wouldn't be exclusive to either, that's right.
But it would just, at what time would it be? 6?
About 4:15.
It would not be after sports practice.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
And just a quick question. Did you think at all about music and the needs there? Are you basically pretty good? I mean, with Mr. S.
Scatterer.
Yes. Mr. Scat.
Scat is what they call him.
Yeah. So, we thought about music. We thought about a number of different areas. At the present time, we feel comfortable with where we stand with music. That doesn't mean that there's not opportunities for us to grow in the area of music in a variety of ways, whether it be by offering additional lesson time, whether it be by splitting up some of our groups into smaller groups, offering more general music. I mean, some of our students don't take general music now, or at one point we had a music elective as part of an exploratory program. Those are things that we don't have presently. So there are opportunities there. That just wasn't where our focus was in this particular year.
And I think last year the ask was for a teacher.
Yeah, special ed.
Yeah, special ed. Is that you're feeling differently now in terms of?
No, I don't feel differently. But quite frankly, that's been proposed a couple of times, and I've gotten the sense of the board on that, and at this point. Being mindful of a very difficult budget year was not something that we brought forward, but my feelings remain the same on that.
Just one more question about music. Additional resources, would that alleviate the problem where kids are being pulled out of other classes for instruction, or is that a scheduling problem?
That's a scheduling issue. I, when it comes to a secondary schedule, it's it's really one of two models that you see schools utilize. It's either music lessons happen outside of the school day, before or after school, or they happen on a rotating pull-out basis in most times. It's just one of those things that goes around from time to time on a listserv that I'm on, for instance, and I would say almost 9-1, it's one of those two things. So no, it's not really a staffing issue.
Very good. So high school. So what are we thinking, gentlemen?
I get very proud of the high school, so we can be here for a while, but I'll try to keep it short.
You get bonus points.
Yes.
Oh, here, I'm sorry.
Thank you, that's right. You know, it's great. One of the beauties of the night and to play it out this way is to really get a sense of the journey that our children and our students take when they're here in Irvington. And, you know, it reminds me of the presentation that Deb and I made at the end of the year last year to the board where, you know, we framed the Irvington High School experience. And, you know, one of the things that we really talked about is how much work and focus has been put in at the high school around trying to look at how we maximize the preparation that our students go through for their post-secondary experiences. And, you know, a lot of the language and a lot of the key points that we're hearing about tonight really resonate. I mean, you know, it comes together in so many different ways at the high school, and it speaks so strongly to the work that we've done. But to piggyback a little bit on what Joyce did as well, I think it's important for us to go back, because last year, the high school made a lot of big asks. And a lot of those asks, quite frankly, were around infrastructure. And one of the things that we realized was as we were looking to really make sure that we're maximizing the experience for our students, there was a couple of key areas that we needed to focus on. One was we came and we talked about asking for a clerical staff member at the high school. And it had, and I thank you, you know, we came forward and did it, and it has had such a profound impact exactly to what we talked about last year. It has stabilized our office to allow not only for Steve and I to be able to spend more time with teachers, to spend more time with guidance counselors, but also to be doing, I think, putting more energy and time into communicating with families about what's going on at the high school. It's allowed us to initiate more meetings, and really it's allowed for there to be a certain calm and stability at the high school, which is what we needed. So it's had a tremendous impact. You know, one of the other asks that we had last year was for a part-time 0.5 psychologist. I know Scott started to talk about it before, but I think in some ways it's a perfect time to talk about it here, because those two things together have created such an important stability and sense of calm in the high school. And one of the things I brought up before was, you know, getting the clerical staff right allowed for Steve and I to reallocate our time and our resources. And one of those are a series of Friday meetings that we now have every single Friday. I'm going to let Steve talk a little about it a little bit, and then he'll talk a little bit about what the additional psychologist has really meant for the high school. Thanks.
Dave actually wrote "stay succinct" for me, so I'll take that as a cue. So the additional psychologist has been fantastic in the sense of, I think there's been direct supports that are just obvious in terms of what the position brings. Which is crisis intervention, allowing that person to be at network meetings, supporting families in different ways, counseling and group counseling, behavior plans, psychological testing, things of that nature that any psychologist who would come in would support. But I think more importantly is the work that's been done at a different level that Dave was alluding to, which was creating collaboration and partnerships within the high school community. I think that perhaps didn't exist before in the sense of having multiple people who could work in that capacity. So I wasn't here last year, but one of the things that Dave and I talked about was that there's a sense that our teachers and our staff and our psychologists are more attuned to our children's needs, that there's more communication around the needs of our students. On Fridays, we have a meeting with our psychologists, which is immediately followed by a meeting with our counselors. So we're taking in the information that we hear about our students who are most at risk and speaking directly to the people that can serve them in other capacities. So ultimately, it's also led, I think, to greater access, you know, with additional staff. We had a situation even just as early as last week where we just required the need of more counselors, more psychologists, more support, and having the capacity to do that, I think, gave us an opportunity to be a community that could really serve our kids in different ways at a time that was most needed.
Thanks, Steve. So, you know, again, I thought it was important to start there because it's the core of the infrastructure. You know, we needed that stability, the emotional stability, for so much of what was going on, but also, you know, the productive stability to reallocate resources. But that brings us back to, you know, so much of our work at the high school, which is about the curriculum. You know, I've heard a lot tonight from my colleagues around, you know, the common languages, and it culminates and, you know, continues at the high school. I think of a lot of the work that Dr. Kaur has helped lead and help us be involved in the work of our world language department around their focus and the shift to, you know, thinking about speaking and listening as a main focal point in the work, and they've been embedded in that for 2 years. I think of, we sat here a month ago and talked about the work of our English department and the anticipation of the Bard writing program, and, you know, again, they're similar in that, and obviously the work that we're all doing as a district, but certainly at the high school level around, you know, curriculum development, and it reminds me of what I've heard from Deb and Dave about the common languages and, you know, about student thinking and our dispositional work at the high school. We've been really focused around collaboration and communication as instructional focal points. So last year we came and we also talked about how we were going to be expanding other things. So, you know, I've heard a lot about PLTW. You know, the excitement is that, you know, we started a PLTW at the high school with what was a singular intro to engineering class. And as the district has been participating in the annual conferences, we've also learned more about what the high school can bring to the table. And one thing was that we needed to turn what was a single class into a three-year sequence. So this year we added the civil engineering and architecture class, and in order to fully implement what would be that three-year sequence, next year we're asking for, but really needing to, add a principles of engineering class, and you know, that will require capacity and the ability to add a point two of teaching support to be able to do that. You know, in addition, in our asks around classes, the rest of it really is about how we take a pause. We've done a lot in the high school in the last 3 years to add courses and to give students a lot more choice and a lot more flexibility in their scheduling. I think now we have the great opportunity to sort of pause around wanting to add a lot more new classes necessarily, but really look at how we schedule and how we make sure that we're putting students not only in the right places, but our class sizes are well balanced. And that creates a need for flexibility. So I know within the budget, there's been an ask for the ability for us to have some flexibility once we start to see student requests, knowing that a certain department may need a sixth class load for a teacher. This year, we actually saw in certain departments that there were some overages. So that support creates something really important for us. But the other thing that I've heard consistently throughout the table tonight has been around the notion of instructional technology. And there's been some great work and some great focus that's been going on at the high school. A lot of teachers have been piloting some great work. Jesse Lubinsky, who's here, has been a great partner around that. But I know that it's time. Our teachers are eager. They're eager for more infrastructure around that. And I'm going to turn the floor back over to Steve again to talk about another one of our big asks this year around technology.
So obviously we think technology is important. So one of the things we want to look into is adding additional Chromebooks. And that essentially would be looking at tubs of Chromebooks of sets of five. So 10 tubs of five, which would be 50 Chromebooks. Difference between a cart and a Chromebook is a cart essentially is a pretty big apparatus that holds about 20 at a time. The tubs hold about five and are more mobile and more accessible for teachers and students to use. The thought here is that it would support a variety of things, collaborative learning experiences in the classroom, entry points into different technologies and applications that we think are very important opportunities for discovery and application, multimedia opportunities, and more importantly, I think more access. I think a lot more access for our students and our teachers to get their hands on Chromebooks and technology in the classroom that is a little more difficult at the time. And I just want to agree with Dave in terms of what I think is our current environment. I think our environment right now, our school community is ready for this. I think there's a lot of work around the committees and technology, building committees and professional development that's been occurring with Google Classroom and Google Docs. There's the mobile computing initiatives. I think we're really engaged. I think our students are engaged. I think our faculty's engaged. And I think utilizing more technology in that capacity would increase our instructional understandings and push our students a little bit further.
Thank you. Well, I mean, we can add more if you'd like.
That was concise.
How long is a Chromebook? There's 50 Chromebooks, but not like it.
No, I mean,
I don't know, Jesse, if you would
speak. Actually, because they're different from laptops in the sense that they're flash memory, so they're really just browser-based OS, so they actually have a little bit of longer shelf life than we've operated with a 5-year replacement cycle on those technology in the district. I would think we're kind of heading into year 3 or 4 with the initial Chromebooks, and we haven't had issues. I don't think just
those. So 50 Chromebooks would really only be, you have to put a replacement every 5 years, and you amortize it over 5 years. 10 a year.
About $40,000 or so?
Well, but once every 5 years.
Yeah, right. But $40,000 amortized.
Well, you need your Chromebook
$8,000.
No, Chromebook is about $300.
$300. I thought it was
$800. Yeah. This is, you know.
Yeah, $15,000.
In a way, I think in the budget, we have to differentiate between things that are significant amounts of money. So really, hiring.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing, talk about them, but they're easy to find money for.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
We've talked about expanding computer science
mm-hmm.
instruction, and my understanding was that in the context of our earlier conversations is that that expansion happens at the high school. It's kind of already built in that we don't have to add staff, which I guess is why you're not specifying it, but maybe there is something that's underneath it all that you go ahead, please.
Yeah.
So I guess I just want to link back to what David said. So David, do you want to, or Dave, do you want to expand on that? How that the library, it's a chain reaction. It's a domino effect. So if we increase,
because that frees up
that's right. So that would increase. That would give us a point to additional technology for David the high school as well as for David and Allison.
And is that the right kind of resource for computer science education?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you have.
Yeah.
I was the one with that.
Yes.
Yeah. So we would be by that model, and you know, I think David, you talked about, you know, quite the bang for the buck with that. So in that proposal, we're looking at enhancing library media services. We're looking at revamping our study skills program, and we're looking at freeing up a 0.4 of technology instruction. So one full-time FTE has that wide-reaching impact. So with the technology front, by taking away the study skills instruction responsibilities, as Raina said, frees up one additional period for middle school, one additional period for high school for pure technology instruction.
Got it.
I just have a, can I make a comment about all this? But, or is there more we are going to go through?
No.
Well, I had one question about foreign language, but
why don't you go ahead and I have a broad comment.
Okay. You know, we've talked sort of on and off now for several years about expanding world language into elementary grades, chiefly fourth and fifth grade, I think. And last year we had a proposal that we decided not to continue with to follow up on. And I'm wondering for next year, as difficult as it may seem, given our budgetary constraints, is there a possibility to put together a proposal that the administration believes in? I think one thing that occurred to me while, when John asked his question very early on, is that perhaps that's the kind of thing that might actually inspire our community to go over the tax cap, because then there's something that people can rally around as an actual tangible benefit for voting for a budget such as this difficult
budget. So put together a proposal, yes, that the administration can stand behind, I think this would be a question mark. And I think that speaks to, I think it's hard to have something, a big item that people rally around every year. And I would say last year we actually saw significant rallying, certainly PTSA support of PLTW. And so when Joyce and I had this conversation along with Deb and Meg, but really looking at Main Street School, I think we need to think long and hard about the implications. So right now in fourth grade, the fourth grade students have two out during, when they have, when Gwen is at Main Street. So this is the same thing that happens in third grade when Gwen is at Dow's Lane. It's 2 hours of time, Project Lead the Way, those modules, in order for the students to have enough time to engage and to work completely through a module where the students go without their teacher for 45 minutes and then with their teacher for an hour and 15 minutes. Right now, that's...
Sorry, is that per week or per...
Per week during the five-week module. So when Joyce and I actually talked about world language and what the implications for that would be, currently our world language program, you know, previously it was in fifth grade. So if we're looking at expanding Project Lead the Way into fifth grade, how many, there just aren't enough hours in the day to support all of the opportunities that we'd like to provide. So I think we're working through now what those options could look like, so we are prepared to share with you what an option like that could be. But I would have to say that I think we're feeling a little pulled in multiple directions, because I think the message that we got loud and clear, and that, by the way, I think we all believe in across the grid, is Project Lead the Way, not just Project Lead the Way, but expanding the opportunities for our students in computer science. And I think that's a message that we're hearing from our community, and I think it's a message that we all believe in. So that's a long answer to say, I think it's really hard to then also think about implementing a world language program. So recently, Deb, Meg, Joyce, and I was supposed to be a real conversation, but it ended up being a conference call conversation with the consultant who's working with our 612 program, who is very, very knowledgeable, well-versed, works all over the world. And he really talked through what a viable world language program is and what is sustainable and actually where the research shows that it makes a difference. And we will be prepared to share that with you. We're working on that now. So I know that's a long answer, but I think it's very complex.
Yeah. And the other piece of this that I have repeated multiple times is that it doesn't make sense, I don't think, for us to extend our language instruction to earlier grades until we really make, you know, have the kids learn more language by the time they're through eighth grade, because right now it's only a year, I think, of high school equivalent language that they're getting in all of their middle school instruction, and that's not much. And if they don't do more than that by adding two grades, there's not really much point in doing it. So that would require more substantive rethink of what we're doing.
Right.
And that would have implications for the high school then, too.
And that's the work we're currently doing now.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. I don't have an immediate sort of response other than that it's good to know that you've thought it through and there are multiple kind of complexities around it.
Yeah. Which we do want to share with you, like, you know,
right.
And engage with you on, because it is complicated.
It's kind of, I think, maybe it's not a bad segue from what you asked about. There was the issue last year in the budget where we had, I'm looking at it, we had response to intervention teacher, special education teacher, more clerical, psychologists, social worker, all good and valuable things, but none of those things are core academics. And again, I think what I'm hearing is a lot of things that aren't really core academics, and it really raises the question of are there, do we want it to be devoting resources to expanding core, you know, our academic options? And that, it's most obvious in the high school, where there are real choices to be made about what subjects, and obviously it would mean more teaching, more teachers and less, you know, and smaller classes, not a bad thing, but there are, you know, I can think of, you know, just off the top of my head, physics. Do we want to offer more physics? Do we want to offer deeper language instruction? Do we want to offer more European history? You know, all of those things, there's a variety of directions we could move, or more honors level courses as opposed to just AP or something else. And we keep expanding in non-core academic areas, and I'm wondering whether we're getting a little imbalance between always expanding in other areas and at the result of really what matters the most for our schools, which is the academics, and which is what, you know, kids are ultimately going to come away with and what the colleges will care about. So that's a question, and I just a concern that I would have about the process we go through, we've gone through for a couple of years.
Can I speak to that for a moment, though? I think that it's a bit of a fallacy to say that the support systems like that are not increasing our academic capacity, because what you talked about was the condition of the social worker and psychologist and even special education teachers, that more of our students spend more time in class being able to access the curriculum and the material than they would be without the support, because we're removing barriers, many of the barriers that students experience that prevent them from accessing the academics and the curriculum are not reading, writing, and arithmetic. You know, there are situations around the way they learn, how they learn, the way that they are feeling internally, the things they're dealing with in the rest of their lives. When we put those supports in place, it allows our students to spend more time and more focused time in the classroom accessing that very academic purpose that we're talking about.
Yeah, no, I get all that, and it's absolutely correct. I'm not disagreeing with that at all, but I'm just after how do we continue, how do we raise the level of excellence in our district, and all of those things about getting kids into a place where they can learn better and having them learn in a you know, mindfulness and all the technology. It's all great and all good stuff, but you know, it just seems like there's also room to think about whether that core can be improved and expanded as well. And that maybe is another path to excellence in the district.
I mean, John, I think you bring up a lot of things that have actually been right at the forefront of our thinking at the high school. I mean, in many ways, I think you're speaking to our broader curriculum at the high school.
It's easiest for me to think about it in the high school, partly as a parent of a high school student, but that's also
so I think
where
I can
the more
speak
choices
to it,
are.
Because I think it's been exactly where we've been focused. At the same time that I highlighted some of our infrastructure asks last year, I don't want to send the message that it was at the expense of also not broadening our curriculum. So, I mean, I know we take great pride in the fact that we added and or brought back an AP computer science class this year, an AP European class to speak to what you just mentioned, AP statistics. We have an environmental sustainability class. We have, obviously, we talked last time I was here about the English curriculum and how we've overhauled that and made a lot of changes. Debate for good or for bad, but I think the students are showing a lot of motivation and a lot of excitement in the courses that we've created. So, and I'm not trying to dismiss what you're saying. I think it is exactly in our focus, and I'm not so sure that just throwing more money is a way to necessarily automatically say we're getting better at it, because there's a point where there's only so many classes that our students can take. So I want our students to have choice. I think that's so important. And a focal point of what we've been doing at the high school. I think in some ways we're at a really good time of not pause in terms of advancing forward, but pause to see how our curriculum is sticking and how it's really serving the needs of our students. While we're not adding to physics, we're actually taking our physics honors class next year and we're running the AP version. Again, my goal isn't to say we're already doing it, don't worry. I think we always want to be working together to keep growing with this, but I think there's been a lot of focus, and I think we have made a lot of strides at the high school in the last few years.
Can I just add to John's question? Are there any classes that are obviously oversubscribed that where we have, you know, that are too large, like I'm thinking like a Latin 1 class?
Or hard to schedule kids into.
Fine.
Maybe, because just they don't want people's schedules.
It doesn't mean like that's not a...
I mean, you're always going to have challenges in a high school. You know, the challenge isn't when I'm oversubscribed, you know, unless I don't have the manpower. The challenge becomes where there's a course we really feel is valuable, but we're undersubscribed. So if I'm only running a single section of something and there's 20 students that are really interested in it, I think there's value in running that for our students. We obviously put it there for a reason, but now that's the nuance of scheduling. Is it going to run? Is it, you know, just because I have 20 that are interested, if only 6 can actually find their way into the class? And you know, what we're also seeing is students want to take a lot of courses, and I'm excited about that. But quite frankly, it also goes back to where we started the conversation tonight around stress factors. And so there's a lot at play. So my goal is to make sure that we have a balanced and well-rounded curriculum so that every student in the high school can maximize their experience. We're not there yet, but I think we've made a lot of strides to get there.
And I think to build upon what you said, some of the work that you're going to do with scheduling in the coming year, starting this spring, kind of leads itself to look at what other opportunities may be there. So is that an opportunity to run courses in a different way, different sequences, to kids find their ways into different courses that they may have challenges with now? Or that opportunity, can you build out more programs? But that's some of the flexibility or the ideas that you may be looking at.
The UBD work and the technology infrastructure increases allow us to increase the level of rigor within the classroom because our teachers are designing their instruction more effectively, and so we're taking the existing coursework and raising the level in all of those courses and increasing the ability.
Sort of reminds me of a term I heard last year, which was quality versus quantity. I hear a lot of work happening to improve with the cross-content work, with the support for students in terms of their social emotional needs, with the curriculum design and mapping. But that's actually, so I want to come at it.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's not.
I just want to ask a question, actually. Thank you. I just want to come at it from a different angle than what John was asking, which is, When I hear these discussions or presentations, what I'm concerned about is time. That do you have time to do this work? Is that something that we're needing? Is that an ask in some way or another angle that we need to come at what we're doing? Because between the curriculum design mapping, the cross-content collaboration, Project Lead the Way, the RTI training, that's a lot of work for our educators to, you know, take in. I mean, are we able to do that?
Well, some of it is overlap, right? I mean, so I think the more, the better designed our units of study are, I think the clearer our teachers are and what they want to teach, which supports our response to intervention and the kind of interventions that teachers need to provide. So I think there is some overlap in some areas. I also think we tap different people for different things. So when we look at Project Lead the Way, for instance, or the Gateway program at the middle school, those are the technology teachers who are specifically working on that. Whereas in the classroom, we're looking at our classroom teachers for tier one interventions for response to intervention. So yes, everybody has too much on their plates. I mean, I think it's the way of the world though. I don't know that we're so different than many other places outside of education today. It's the nature of teaching and learning today. Our kids have a lot on their plates, our teachers have a lot on their plates, we have a lot on our plates. I don't know what the answer is. I think we do a lot around trying to monitor that and not keep throwing out new initiatives and saying, well, this is a good idea, let's try this. I think we're trying to be clear, cohesive, consistent, and comprehensive.
And I think Randy wrapped it up so well. And the thought, you know, of where we are and linking to Michael's comments and all the way back to John, if we go back and look at what we've done with this team, with the Board of Education, prior board members, what we've done in this district in the last 3-4 years, whether that's new opportunities that have been afforded our children, a focus on our facilities, looking at infrastructure, human resources, and the deep, deep focus on improving the quality of instruction to enhance learning, it doesn't stop. And there's going to be times when we go through cycles. Sometimes those cycles are going to be linked to budget. Sometimes those cycles are going to be linked to capacity and being able to now stop and monitor what we're doing. We've come a long, long way in a short period of time, and we all want more. We all want to see more opportunities for our kids. We want to see our kids' academic growth and social growth faster. We want to see our kids get into the best colleges. But sometimes we forget to stop and look at the good things that we've done. And we've come a huge distance in such a short period of time. And it's something I think I know that I'm proud of, and I think my colleagues are, but this whole community should be proud of. It doesn't mean that we stop now. It means that our work goes in different directions. Sometimes you got to go down before you can go out again. And we're worried about those capacity issues, Michael. We're worried about those time issues. As Raina said, it's different people doing different work, but everybody's dancing as fast as they can. So now it's looking to make sure what we're doing it well, and making sure we're providing quality experiences in every classroom for every child every day. So, you know, the work will continue. You know, we deliberately didn't have the conversation about world language because we're still trying to figure it out. It's so very complex. We're still trying to figure out different aspects of what we can do with our students that are struggling, and then how to enrich experiences for kids everywhere. So it's going to be a journey. This budget process is going to be very, very difficult. And I think tonight was a good starting point for us to have the conversation about where we're going to go. The board and community can trust that those needs that my colleagues brought up are things that you're going to see come up, but all within the context of a very difficult financial world for us. So that next meeting on February 9th, and as Phil said earlier, we hope that a lot of people tune in, come to the meeting, because we're going to map out what those financial challenges are for the district. And then the two meetings following that, we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of what the budget is, what our needs are, and what those costs are going to be. And we're going to be left at the end of the day with conversations about, you know, are we going to have to go down the path of cutting like we did, you know, 6-10 years ago in that window? Or are we in that position where we're motivated and inspired that we think, no, you know what, we need more. And we need to do this because this is what our kids deserve. We need to continue to grow those experiences. We need to continue to find those additional resources to make sure that not only can we add other experiences for our kids, that we can support the programs that are there, but we can support our teachers to be able to do well in the classroom on a daily basis. So it's going to be a difficult journey for us this spring. But I'm sure at the end of it, after some passion conversation and a lot of soul searching, we're going to come up with the right solution for our kids and for our community. So with that, unless Mr. Whitney, you have any closing words, I want to thank my colleagues for a great conversation.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the detailed presentations or discussions. It was very helpful. So we have comments from the community, which I don't want to lose because I know Dave. But David, can you just hold on for one more minute? Because I'm just going to suggest a quick bio break, and let's get back here in like 4 minutes.
Four?
Yeah. Not five, but four. Just wait. I have
just wait. Yeah.
Sorry? How many questions would you have? It's a little later round.
Okay, good.
That's all
so
I have.
So you'll be there tonight.
Yeah.
Oh, perfect.
I have it all.
I also sent you an email and I checked my calendar tonight and I was like, oh, I didn't remind you.
So I was trying to decide if I time between now and tomorrow to look at it. But I'm making sure I do it.
Can you share it with me so I can print it when I first get in and give it to
you? You don't want to print it.
No, share it with me and we can open it in the
okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank
I'll
you.
Do that.
I'm trying to get to my own board meeting right now.
Students are
Pearl. See that?
See, I get something.
You might not get
job.
Your errands done, but you get
get
down.
You
get
I haven't been able to get them done for a week.
After soon they become irrelevant and you just move on.
So true. So true. You just determine what really matters.
I know.
And somehow that stuff does get done.
I was going to stay for the whole meeting.
Right, no, no problem. So now I'm missing, Bob's not here. Do you see Nikki?
Yeah.
So good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm here. Said 4 minutes, I'm back in three. This is nice. Thank you, Allison. Dave definitely gets points. He was shorter. Okay, it's now 4 minutes, and I'm here. We need quorum again.
Do that in public school, budgeting? Do we? Amortize?
No.
Okay, let's.
I didn't think so.
PSA, President, go back to your. Oh, wait. Are we all supposed to get transits now?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, we will continue our meeting. So I'll bring us back to order here with our. Catherine will be back in a minute, but we have quorum.
You did.
David. The mic is yours.
My name is David Rubin, I'm a fifth high school driver. By way of credential, let me say that I was the sports editor of my high school newspaper, I was the sports editor of my college newspaper, and I've been in the same fantasy baseball league for 35 years.
35 years.
That's my credential. What is my comment tonight? My comment tonight is that I think that the board needs to take up an issue, not to resolve tonight, but the issue that I think they should take up is to get rid of football. And I say that for primarily, I have a look, I'm not going to, there's so many articles out there right now. Here's two sentences written by two doctors from the University of Minnesota. Catastrophic brain injuries, though rare, are far more common in high school. College players have experienced a previous non-catastrophic concussion. The brains of children are more susceptible to long-term damage from concussion than adults. Now, there are three points that I think you guys should consider. One is that we're putting our kids at ridiculous risk. We never knew this years ago, but the incidence of concussion and long-term injury is becoming much. better known and better understood by everyone in the country, okay? The opportunities, where I swore I would never use again after sitting there for a while, the opportunities for us to be sued are going to increase dramatically. Suits have already been filed in places across the country because of, and school districts have been potentially held liable. Now, I'm sure that we take a lot of precautions, we do everything right that we should be doing. Nevertheless, you know what happens when you have to defend yourself and you can still lose, even if you do everything right, that's two. And the third thing is, all I keep on hearing is we're gonna have budget cuts. Here's a chance to save some money, because I'm sure it doesn't cost nothing to have a football team every year, and we'll also save our fields. So that's my comment. I don't know if you guys wanna react to it. I think that, I think you should take it up as an issue and maybe come back with some evaluation analysis about whether it's
Thank you very much. Obviously, it's a concern of the board, and I presume people in the community as well, because we read the same things that you read. And I was just reading this guy, Greg Easterbrook, who writes for the New York Times, the Tuesday morning quarterback, and he's obviously a big football guy because he writes about the games over the weekend. He inserts paragraphs in there every so often that are about the risk of bodily harm to young football players, and so it's something that is in the common discussion these days. I think the most important thing is that we set up a structured discussion for having this important topic exposed, because we need to hear from both sides of the community. All sides of the community. It doesn't have to be both sides, because there certainly are a lot of different opinions about this, and it's something that I think makes sense for us to, as a board, to engage our community with. Which is not good English, that's what happens at 10 o'clock at night, but.
You play football.
Yeah, that's part of the problem. You still have your clever gene going now.
Yeah, I stopped playing in seventh grade, so.
But I think, and I think we shouldn't, get into too much discussion, because it's not fair to, because this is going to be such a passionate topic for our community.
Well, I think what we need is maybe some fact-finding somehow. I mean, there is also, once we know the facts about what the risks are and clarify, and the question is, I think we also have to ask what the risks are for football relative to other sports. I mean, it's not like other sports are risk-free. A lot of sports have concussion risks, and if football might be a little more risky or a lot more risky, and then that might play into our discussion too.
Well said.
If it's just a little more risky, it's hard to single out football, I think, but if it's a lot more risky, maybe there's a case. So I think getting those facts, I don't know how we go about that, but maybe that's something we could charge the administration with, or we could do it as a board, but offline is how do we go about those facts, and then we can decide. Once we know the facts, the community can weigh in. Obviously, there'll be a lot of people who care a lot about this on both sides of the issue, and we can try to balance that, but we need to know the facts better, I think.
Yeah. Couldn't agree more.
Are you going to tell us the facts, or
anything? No, I mean, if you want, there's a billion stories out there.
I know there are a billion stories, but I don't know that this. Yeah, I guess I'd like to see, to me at least, more quantitative analysis and qualitative story analysis. But
thank you. Any other questions or comments on anything else that appeared on the agenda tonight?
But I'm sorry, can I just say, I think David is actually right that this is something, just given the media attention and all of the developments on all the different levels of football, especially in the pro level, that it's something that we really do, I think it is our duty to take a look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And decide what we need, and take a look with fresh eyes at what we need to do with this. Even though I know it's an important part of our community and something that a lot of people hold dearly, it's something that we would be remiss not to at least think about carefully.
Yep. So, all right, we're done with that, so we can move on to our consent agenda, and that gives an opportunity for our few remaining guests to leave. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for coming.
So our consent agenda tonight is relatively brief, but as always, Are there any items that stand out that I should pull out now as things that would likely be voted against? Anything that comes to mind?
No.
Okay. So why don't we just accept our consent agenda and then we can discuss the items as usual. Can I have a motion to accept the consent agenda, which is 7, 1, 8, and all of 8? Can I have that motion, please?
So moved.
Have a second?
Second.
Thank you. So now, to ask any questions, discuss any items. Nothing?
Nope.
All right. So we will move speedily to a vote. All in favor of this consent agenda?
Aye.
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 And that is our agenda. Wow, that happened so quickly, that really took my breath away.
I surprised you, didn't I?
Yes, you did, John. That's okay. I like to be surprised, happily. So any other Board of Ed discussion items?
Yeah, I'd like to raise one. I don't feel like we're hearing very much about the strategic planning process and what's going on in that as a board. And you know, what I have heard and what I have seen, which was the memo that I guess got lost in your inbox, and we didn't see it. It's kind of late, and the I haven't, what I've seen is a little bit concerning, and I feel like I'm concerned that that's going to be delivered on our doorstep as kind of a done deal, and we're not really going to have much input into what's going on in it. And so I'd just like to ask that we be better informed, that maybe we put that on board agenda so we keep on, because I'm concerned that this process is just, there's radio silence on this process.
Right. Fair enough. We will talk about it on February 9th. How's that?
Okay. I mean, I don't even know when it's going to happen. When are we going to get this report? No, it's much less what's going to be in it.
Right. Our next meeting is February 9th at 7:30. And that concludes our public meeting. Can I have a motion to move into executive session for the purpose of discussing collective negotiations?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.